Guys, I want to thank the sponsors of the podcast. I want to thank GoHunt.com, my friend Cody Nelson, the glassing guru, the optics authority. He's the optics manager at GoHunt.com. If you have any interest in buying optics or have any glassing questions, whether it be tripods, spotting scopes, rifle scopes, range finders, anything to do with glassing, give Cody a call, 702-847-8747. That's extension 2, or you can email him at optics@gohunt.com. You can also send him a text or call him on his cell phone at 602-399-3699. Guys, right now at GoHunt.com Insider, you can take advantage of the free trial. Go to GoHunt.com/J Scott. You're going to be able to take advantage of a free trial of the Insider. GoHunt is always adding more value for their Insider members. They've now added real 3D maps as a part of Insider for no additional cost. What an incredible value. Very soon, they're going to have their mobile app up as well. Go to GoHunt.com/J Scott and sign up for a free trial. If you're already an Insider member, it's automatically part of your Insider membership. And you can just go to the Maps tab up at the top once you sign in as an Insider. I also want to thank Kuyu Ultralight Hunting. That's the gear that I wear on all of my hunts. To find out more, you can go to KUIU.com, Kuyu.com. They're a direct-to-consumer company. They sell everything off of the Kuyu.com website. I also do a lot of question and answer on my Instagram, where I'm answering questions about guys wanting to know about gear about Kuyu, so tune into my Instagram. I want to thank Kuyu for their sponsorship. I also want to thank Phonescope.com. Use the JScott20 promo code. You're going to get a 10% discount on all orders. Again, thanks to all the sponsors of my podcast. Guys, welcome to the J. Scott Outdoors podcast. We've got our friend Daniel Franco of Burnt Timber Outfitters. Daniel owns and operates with Mike Hancock up there out of Heber, Overgaard area, born and raised. Daniel, how you doing?
Doing good, Jay.
Anxious to get you on the phone to talk to you a little bit about this last storm here for 3C and those Rim Country units. Before we get to that, you were down in Mexico with Dar. Looks like you guys had a hoot of a time down there.
Oh, yeah. It's always a good time down in Mexico.
And looks like you and Craig educated Dar on a few finer points of life.
Well, you know how Craig Blackburn is.
Yeah.
He's one of a kind. Yeah, exactly.
When both of us are thinking of something to say and we say he's one of a kind, it pretty much sums it up right there.
We got to be politically correct, you know.
You guys had a lot of fun. Kind of right in the middle of down there in Mexico on that second week, we've got that big storm, which I want to talk to you about with Arizona and how you feel that storm impacted those that are thinking about applying for the draw. We're here in the last few days with the draw being due on February 9th on Tuesday, I believe by 7 or don't quote me on that, but by tomorrow night.
I think it's, midnight.
Yeah. So what do you think about this final storm that we got? You know, we're trying to gather all the data that we can prior to applying, and, you know, we do the best we can with what we have, but where are we at? What are your thoughts?
Well, I mean, obviously any storm is good. I think right here in Heber, like you said, we were in Mexico, so I wasn't actually here for it, but once I got here and saw kind of what it did, hearing kind of conflicting reports, somewhere between a foot to 16 inches roughly of snow, absolutely 100% will take it. It's for the most part, it's melting off, still quite a bit of snow on the north sides, but for the most part, it's melted off fairly slow. The ground is getting good and saturated, muddy. As usual, is what we normally get out of snows, which is going to be good. I mean, that's going to get into the ground. It's going to at least give us some good moisture for that first little bit of spring when stuff does start to green up. To be a little optimistic, I'm hoping that it does do some good. I've been a little bit pessimistic going into this draw, just based off of what we saw at the end of last year. We happened to kill some late bulls last year in 3A, 3C on the late hunt. One of our guides, his wife had a unit one cow tag in December. And boy, the elk were not in the best of shape. Of the late bulls that we did kill last year, five of them, I believe, none of them had any fat on them. Normally by the time that late hunt rolls around, the rut's been over for, you know, a month, month and a half, and they've been kind of gorging themselves, trying to build back up for winter. And normally by then, you know, they'll start to build up some fat and have some fat reserves to roll into the kind of the heaviest parts of winter. And, none of the bulls did, from the low country in 3A clear to the high country in 3C. They were just in pretty poor shape. No fat buildup. Still kind of skinny from the rut. So, you know, that's kind of been weighing on my mind, you know, going into this winter, into spring, and into next year's draw. My guide's wife that had the cow tag in unit one, she shot a cow. You know, best we were guessing, probably a yearling or 2 year old cow. My guide said it was in probably the poorest shape that he's ever seen an elk. Hip bones were sticking out, ribs were showing, top of the shoulder blades were sticking up, not an ounce of fat. He anticipated it was probably 100 to 150 pounds underweight of what it should have been. She's had that tag multiple times and killed a cow every time, and he said it was just not good to see the condition that cow was in and that the elk were in, you know, at the end of this year. So
let me ask you a question. Do you think this storm was enough to add pressure to the already condition that wasn't good? In other words, do you think 16 inches is enough that makes it where, you know, they struggle to get feed, or not at all?
No, I don't think so. I mean, the beauty of our snowstorms is they hit, they'll stick around for a little bit. The snow on the north slopes, you know, obviously will stick around longer, but I think it melts off fairly quick. So they're not having to fight for food. I don't think that's an issue. In fact, I think, like I said, I think it does more good than anything, just to get that moisture in the ground and try to get some proteins and nutrients built up as quick as we can in new growth. So
does this storm change your outlook as far as prior to the storm? Were you telling people, hey, you might consider a bonus point, might consider not applying? Does this storm in your mind create a window or an opportunity where you could see that potentially we could pull out and potentially have a decent antler growth year for this upcoming season?
With this one storm, no. I, you know, guys apply for years and years and years to finally draw an elk tag in Arizona. I mean, a lot of these guys have, you know, 20 plus years built up in applying. And, you know, based off of what we've seen and, you know, previous year's experience in, you know, the White Mountains and stuff for elk and moisture and whatnot, I don't think this one storm is going to change much. And the reason I say that is the feed that is out there right now is strictly, in my opinion, sustaining life. I don't think it has a lot of nutrients. We didn't get our monsoons. It was dry throughout, you know, the majority of the summer and fall last year. So the feed that's there is basically just sustaining life. It's not building fat as we saw on the late bulls that we killed this year. So I think this storm here, yes, it is going to give us some new growth this spring. But I think what nutrients the animals, the elk, do get from that fresh growth and all the new growth, I think that's going to take more than just this one storm in order to start to replenish the animal, the body, back to their healthy state, to where it starts to to roll over and overflow into their antler growth.
Playing the devil's advocate, we've got this storm that we had. There's not really a ton in the forecast, but let's just say that we could put together another storm in, say, 2-3 weeks and put another one together in 2-3 weeks. I mean, is there a scenario that could play out in your mind, or do we need one of those, you know, just every week another storm, every week another storm, for it to be average or above average?
No, I think if we can get some moisture, I mean, every other week, as long as we can string together, you know, a couple more storms here in February and into March, and a couple of rains in even April. I mean, we don't get a lot in May. We get very, very little in May, but even a little shower or two in May, I think that'll help a ton. Will it completely recover us? I don't know. I would like to be optimistic and say yes, but I think the elk are coming off of such a bad year and just malnutritioned, and I don't think they have, I don't think they're healthy enough for that to to turn over into,
to translate,
know, antler growth.
Into antler,
yeah, growth. Translate into antler growth.
Gotcha.
So,
Daniel, I'm looking here at the Go Hunt Insider, and to remind the listeners, if you're not a Go Hunt Insider member, you can go to gohunt.com/JScott. You can sign up to be a Go Hunt Insider member. I'm looking at the draw odds here, and it's kind of mind-blowing to me. I want to go over a couple things. As someone born and raised there in Heber, Arizona, and about getting closer to the century mark in your life, been doing this a long time, I'm looking at 3A, 3C archery, September 10th through the 23rd. There's a couple things I want to ask you about that, but
okay. Look
at the point totals, and it's 22 points to guarantee a tag, and 21 has a 60% chance. You take that over to unit one, where it's 18 points is guaranteed, so 4 less points for unit one. That's one thing I want to point out. Then you look over at 4B, which is right across the street, and it's only 11 points to guarantee a tag. It's jumping around there. The biggest thing that jumps out at me is the difference between 1 and 3C, in that people obviously think that 3C is that much better than unit 1 to be 4 points more than an 18-point 100% total in unit 1. Your thoughts on that, just as someone that's born and raised there?
Well, you know, it's funny because 5-6 years ago, that was flipped. Unit 1 was the harder unit to draw. And unfortunately, with unit 1, a lot of the elk winter in unit 1. So when you hand out, you know, a couple hundred, 300-400 late bull tags, and your age class, your older age class bulls are getting killed on those late hunts, we have seen a pretty rapid, steady decrease in quality in unit 1.
Don't you think, with the fire and the availability of great glassing in unit 1 and the added tag numbers, the kill ratio, people are just wiping them out? I mean,
yeah,
they're very
they're,
visible.
They're,
and, you know,
absolutely.
Like in 3C, wouldn't you agree that a lot of your elk go and they winter on the reservation, where in unit 1, a lot of elk winter right there in 27 or in 1, and now the wallow fire has made it where they're so glassable and actually made those late hunts great for seeing elk, but they're killing the crud out of them?
Yes, absolutely, 100%, yeah. Yeah, I mean, that's one kind of one of the positives of 3A, 3C, or 3C, you know, in particular, is those elk, they have that safe haven. They have that whole southern boundary of the unit is Fort Apache Indian Reservation. So they've got a place to go once that rut's over, where they can get away from people. Get away from, you know, the late hunters. So yeah, the late hunt in 3C, it's tough. It's a grind. Because a lot of the bulls that are in the unit in September are not there, whereas in unit 1, they winter in the unit. It is more open, it's more glassable, and you know, with the added tag numbers, it's hurting the quality for sure. So I think that's the biggest reason for the 4 points difference for non-residents for between unit 1 and 3C.
You look at those season dates of September 10th through the 23rd. What immediately jumps out at you when you hear those dates?
It's a little early. Some would probably claim it's too early. They'll be talking by then. They'll be bugling. I mean, they're not going to be full blown rutting. Typically, what we've seen, the rut in 3C, it always seems to kind of hit that 20th through the 24th. So, I mean, as long as that's always in the archery season, then, you know, we're always going to have a really good hunt. The 10th, yeah, might be slightly early, but to be honest with you, I kind of like that little bit of an earlier start, because if you can find a big bull and have him located, a lot of times it's easier to get him killed before he gets to rutting and running around and, you know, turning into a nomad and traveling all over and checking different cows. So it's kind of a double-edged sword. Might be a little early, but with the right scenario and the right circumstances, it can actually help you.
I'm looking here at the 3A, 3C, November 26th through December 2nd, so the late rifle hunts. Looks like it takes 9 points to guarantee, 8 points is 51%. Every year you talk about how tough the late hunts are, and then you guys turn around and whack them up pretty good. So every year you say, oh, it's tough and this and that, and you guys actually do pretty dang good on those late hunts. Is a lot of that because of how well you just kind of know the little pockets and places where to go?
Yeah, I mean, to be honest, those late hunts, I mean, we kind of never know what to expect on those until, you know, the 2 or 3 weeks leading up to the start of that hunt, because you don't know which bulls are going to stay in the unit. You don't know which bulls have left. So for us, I firmly believe that our secret to success is the 3 weeks leading up to the start of that late elk hunt. As soon as we're done with our mule deer hunts, we start scouting for that late elk hunt. And I mean, we pound it from the lowest country we can find in 3A to the highest country we can find in 3C and everything in between. And just try to see what sticks around and what stayed and where they're at and where the pockets are. And last year was a little different because of water. It was so dry that kind of changed things up a little bit. But like you said, we've been very fortunate. We've had some really good success on those late hunts, but they are a grind. They're tough. It's not uncommon to not get over 40 degrees on a day with winds and snow and you're trying to grind it out, trying to find a bull that's intact, something that's not broke and something that has some maturity to it. So it can be tough, but we've been fortunate the last couple of years.
What would you say if you're looking at, and let's kind of talk back to archery elk and 3C trend, pre-fire, then after the fire, and all of a sudden 3C was just trending. You shot a phenomenal bull yourself, and, you know, then you guys were really doing well with some bulls, and it kind of lulled, and it seems like the quality has kind of come back. That's just my perception for someone that used to run around in there a lot. Nowhere near as much as you do. What's your thoughts on overall trend? Is it holding? Is it climbing? Is it declining? What are your thoughts on that archery elk hunt as far as size?
I would say it's holding. It's funny, every same thing every year is just a little bit different. You know, some years, you know, it kind of surprises you. You see some pretty dang good bulls and you're like, wow, I wasn't expecting that. And then years when you think, oh no, this is going to be the year, it seems like we don't quite see as big of bulls as we would hope to see. But I think it just varies a little bit. I think it's holding for the most part. I would still consider it to be one of the top archery hunts in the state as far as quality. I think it's been producing over the last couple years consistently. And I think that's another reason that you see such a big jump in the in the points required to draw in the max pull for non-residents. So,
would you say the early rifle hunt is right in the wheelhouse of the dates with the 24th through the 30th? I mean, it's before the breakage. Yeah. It kind of goes in that 20th to 24th where you said they really get after it. As far as a bugling, chaotic, good rutting hunt, that's about as good a dates as you can get, isn't it?
That's about as good as you're going to get, yeah. We've seen it where when you start rolling closer into October and into the first part of October, especially if you get any moisture, it kind of tends to shut them down a little bit and can make it, a little bit harder. But, yeah, this, with it being completely in the last week of September, it's going to be crazy. It's going to be super good.
Let's talk a little bit about the redheaded buck two stepchild of a unit right to the north, 4B. I like how you're laughing. You didn't know I could say that on my own podcast, did you?
No, I didn't think that was politically correct.
it's a unit that's so goofy because it's very difficult, I think, because of its flat nature, not really that much glassing at all, and kind of spread out, kind of spotty. You hear mixed reports. You hear some guys go up there and have, a decent archery hunt. You hear a lot of people kind of complain about people, and I think it's a unit that kind of jams people on top of each other. And then every once in a while, a good bull will come out, but for the most part, all you hear is the sob stories.
Well, yeah, I think the biggest thing, there's only 125 archery bull tags in the unit, which it's not like that's an astronomical amount. It's not like it's, in my opinion, too many. The bigger issue is kind of the water, because depending on your water in that unit, that will determine where your elk congregate. And it's not like a 3C or a 1 or, 23 North or some of these other units where, you can pretty much go out on any given day, drive down the road, park, get out, and you're going to hear a bull bugle. In 4B, they're definitely more pocketed. You've got your pockets over here, pockets over there, and a lot of that is dependent on water that for that time of year. So what it ends up doing is it ends up putting more hunters on top of each other, so
kind of jams them up because everybody's kind of chasing the same elk, and
exactly
so a little bit of bugling and they're out at night listening and everybody's clammed up on the same pocket in the morning.
Exactly. Yep. So you run into that quite a bit, and that's where you get a lot of the mixed reviews. Now if you can find areas and little pockets that are out of the way, places that the Joe public doesn't know about, you can get off into some areas and into some pockets and have some bulls to yourself. And some guys, do that, and they have a phenomenal hunt. So I think that's the biggest thing. I think that's where you get a lot of the mixed reviews on the unit. I've hunted it, quite a few times. I've kind of helped guys in the unit. I've actually guided in the unit. So it kind of depends. It changes year to year. It all depends on who draws the tags as to, is this little honey hole going to have five other guys in there?
If Colburn, then you shoot a big bull. Is that what you're telling me? Every time you help the Colburns, it's like big bull down. I get another text, big bull down, and Daniel's smiling face is the first one I see. But
yeah, well, I'll tell you what, you got to have that Colburn luck.
That's not the norm, though. I mean, would you agree? I mean, it's a tough unit.
It is a tough unit. It definitely is a tough unit. I mean, I think a lot of that is, just having hunted it for my entire life and knowing a lot of these little pockets and, if there's people here, then we need to go check over here and go check this and go check that. Yeah. Just little stuff like that. And that's, kind of what I've been able to do with Dar and Parker. The last couple tags they've had is, go try this, go check that. Ooh, there's no water there. Go check over here. See if there's water there. Oh, yep, here's cows. Okay, there's going to be. Yeah, bulls there type of deal. So,
but I do recall texts from Dar saying, "I'm never doing this again." And I'm like, "Well, you told me that a couple of years ago." And but I'm never doing this again. And then all of a sudden, here's a smiling picture of a smiling face of a big bull, and it's like, okay. I want to shift gears real fast. We're not going to go into depth, but you're such a sandbagger, you and Mikey. I have you on the podcast.
Is that politically correct?
Talking about mule deer, and you're like, yeah, 3C, you know, it's kind of coming along and this and that. And then you just slay them again on the mule deer hunt. And we're going to talk more when we get into May and June. But your outlook for mule deer, and what are the mule deer and 3C doing? And give me the real scoop, because this, I think like 170, 180, and then you're like 206, 199, 201. I'm like, you got to be kidding me.
I'm not sandbagging. I'm just not playing all my cards. That's all. So I think the mule deer and 3C are doing good. I still think we're seeing a slight decline in numbers of mature deer, to be brutally honest. Going into last year, I was a little bit skeptical. And then as the weeks of scouting started to take place and we started to kind of get an inventory of bucks, it quickly changed to more optimistic. Going into this year, we're pretty optimistic, I'll tell you that. There's quite a few bucks that we know about that made it through the season last year. Barring, you know, they don't get lion killed or poached or both. I think there will be a pretty good inventory of bucks next year. That's kind of our anticipation and our hope.
Okay.
What's the drought going to do? That's the wild card.
Yeah. And we can talk about more of it when we get into the deer and, sheep stuff. But, let's see, what else was I going to bust you about? I do want to bust your chops about a recent video on Instagram where it looked like Daddy was searching for his last breath of oxygen on a big elk shed. You dropped off into some hole gathering oxygen, and there's my buddy just breathing like a stuck man. Tell me about that.
So that was down in 23.
Was that a dare that you lost a bet on and had to go climb down there and get it?
No, it was one of them stupid curiosity kills the cat type of deal. So we were down in 23 this last December with Mike's youngest boy, Dane. He had a coos deer tag. And one of the mornings there, we're glassing this awful country, as you know, 23. And Devin ends up glassing up this shed, and he's like, "Hey, I got a pretty good shed over here." So we look at it, and I spotting scope it, and I'm going, "Man, you know, good bottom end, good third, good fours." I said, "Man, that's a pretty big shed." Well, none of us were feeling young enough that we wanted to cross this ginormous canyon to go get it that day. So we left and went and hunted coos deer, and it's just been kind of eating at me this whole time, going, "Man, I'd like to see what this shed is." And more than that, I've picked up other sheds in this area and was kind of wondering if it was maybe a match to one I'd picked up previously or whatnot. So the other day I got a bonehead idea to go down there and retrieve it. And, well, needless to say, I'm not in the shape I used to be in, unless you consider round a shape. No, it was nasty. It was, it didn't look that bad when you're glassing across the canyon at it, but to drop off into this nasty canyon and back up the other side, it was way worse than I was anticipating. And I was hoping to find the other side, and that didn't happen either. So
it was a pretty good shed, wasn't it?
It was. So it's 177 3/8 single.
Nice.
So I mean, give him a matching other side with a 38-inch spread, and I mean, he's going to be right there in the low 390s.
Yeah, beautiful.
So yeah, really good shed.
Awesome, man.
About 3 years older than I like to see him, but you know, whatever.
Yeah, I had to give you a hard time about that. I just cracked up. That was kind of made my whole month, actually.
Shoot,
because I've followed you around enough with my tongue out, so watching you struggle for oxygen, I just enjoyed that. Buddy, it's always great having you on the podcast. Guys, check out Burnt Timber Outfitters. Daniel, want to give you a chance to let people know how they can reach you guys. If you got a 3C tag, 4B, Unit 1, any of those Rim Country units, give these guys a call. But Daniel, tell everybody where they can find you, and I'll link it up in the show notes as well.
So we actually just updated our website. I think on our last podcast we were talking that we got hacked, and when you would Google search it, it would take you to a site selling Viagra. So we're no longer in the Viagra business. We've got our updated site up, changed it, changed profile, different things. So you can find us at burntimberoutfitters.com. You can Google search it, do whatever. It's got all of our pictures, contact information, email, cell phone numbers. Or you can follow us on Instagram at Burnt Timber Outfitters. We also have a Facebook page. We don't update it near as often as we should. We do keep our Instagram and also personal accounts, which is Franco_BTO. Or for Mike, it's Mikey with two E's _BTO. Awesome. We try to post as much as we can. So,
right on, man. Great having you on the podcast. Let's keep it snowing, get some moisture, keep it coming, and hope for the Amen. Best. And God bless. It's always great talking to you. I know Dar had a ball with you guys in Mexico, so we'll be chatting at you down the road. Okay.
Okay.
All right, buddy.
Thanks, Jay.
Bye.